Infection control in operation theatres. Surgical care is an integral part of healthcare throughout the world, with an estimated 234 million operations performed annually. Surgical site infections, or SSIs, remain one of the most common causes of serious surgical complications. They account for 14% to 17% of all hospital-acquired infections and 38% of nosocomial infections in surgical patients. The risk of developing SSI varies greatly according to the nature of the operative procedure and the specific clinical characteristics of the patients undergoing the procedure. Potential patient-related factors include malnutrition, old age, coexistent infection, and diabetes. External risk factors include the type and duration of operation, surgeon skills, the quality of preoperative skin preparation, adequacy and timing of antimicrobial prophylaxis, insertion of foreign material or implants, inadequate sterilization of surgical instruments. The rate of surgical wound infections is strongly influenced by operating theatre quality too. A safe and salubrious operating theatre is an environment in which all sources of pollution and any micro-environmental alterations are kept strictly under control. This can be achieved only through careful planning, maintenance, and periodic checks, as well as proper ongoing training for staff. Structural features. The structural features of the operating unit can influence not only the efficacy of the treatment provided, but also the outcome of the patient in terms of the prevention of surgical infections. The design of the operating unit is complex and requires that different areas be correctly integrated. In addition to keeping clean and dirty areas separate, it is important to ensure that patient flow from arrival to discharge is orderly and logical. Specific rooms should be designated for performing surgical procedures and for processing instruments and other items. It is important to control traffic and activities in these areas since the number of people and the amount of activity influence the number of microorganisms that are present and therefore influence the risk of infection. Restricted entry is extremely important. The operating unit should be arranged in progressively less contaminated areas from the reception area to the operating theatres. Moreover, organizational or functional and or structural intervention must be implemented in order to ensure that dirty and clean pathways be kept separate. The size of storage areas for dirty material, clean material, supplies, instruments, equipment, and drugs must be determined in accordance with the type and volume of activity of the operating unit. Moreover, in designing an operating unit, the choice of surface finishes, structural features, is of great importance. Surfaces should be easy to clean in order to facilitate infection control. Design, layouts, fittings, furnishings, floor coverings, and finishes will have a significant impact on the cleaning of the unit. Ledges, corners, and all other surfaces that is difficult to clean should be minimized. The surfaces of floors should be impervious to moisture, easily cleaned, stain resistant, comfortable for long periods of standing, and suitable for wheeled traffic. Window frames should be designed in such a way that their surfaces are easy to clean and do not collect dust. Cleaning and fumigation. Cleaning of operation theatre should follow guidelines mentioned for patient care areas. Dedicated staff should be supervised for cleaning activities. They should wear appropriate PPE while cleaning. A high-level disinfectant is diluted as per manufacturer's recommendation. It is used for cleaning and disinfection of surfaces, for example, the OT tables. Always use clean linen preoperatively. Fumigation with formaldehyde is not recommended since it is toxic. Alternate methods of fumigation may be used with commercially available chemicals. Always follow manufacturer's recommendations. Appropriate procedure needs to be followed for fumigation, keeping all doors and windows closed, keeping all staff and patients out from the fumigation area, and may be done on holidays or when the OT is non-operational. Ventilation. During surgical procedures, dust particles, textile fibers, skin scales, and respiratory aerosols loaded with viable microorganisms are released from the surgical team and the surrounding into the air of the operating theatre. Bacteria settling on surgical instruments or entering directly into the surgical site may result in surgical site infection. Therefore, maintaining a high quality of the air in the operating theatre is essential to controlling the risk of surgical infections. In this regard, a fundamental role is played by the contamination-controlled airflow system like heating, ventilation, air conditioning system, etc. Indeed, in addition to maintaining temperature and humidity at optimal levels, this system provides ventilation that is able to keep the concentrations of gaseous pollutants, particulates, and airborne microbes below predetermined levels. The air in operating theatres should be kept at a higher pressure than in corridors and adjacent areas. This positive pressure prevents the flow of air from less sterile areas into more sterile ones. With regard to ventilation, various international scientific organizations recommend a minimum of 15 air exchanges per hour.
Infection control in operation theatres. The water distribution system in hospitals may constitute a source of healthcare-associated infections caused by opportunistic pathogens such as Pseudomonas aeruginosa, Stenotrophomonas maltophilia, Burkholderia sipacea, Acinetobacter species, and fungi. Taps are common sources of Pseudomonas aeruginosa and other gram-negative bacteria and have ever been linked to infections in multiple hospital settings.
Immunocompromised patients are particularly susceptible to infection caused by waterborne microorganisms, which can cause bacteremia, meningitis, urinary tract infections, and surgical site infections. Surgical hand antisepsis with medicated soap requires clean water to rinse the hands after application of the medicated soap. Procedural and behavioral factors. A behavioral approach aims to reduce the number of airborne particles in the operating theatre through disciplinary measures. Simple and cheap measures include limiting the number of personnel in the operation theatre and restricting the movements of personnel in operating theatre to a minimum, as it has been shown that increased activity facilitates the dispersion of bacteria. Change the clothes before entering operation theatre. In addition to the number and movements of personnel in the operating theatre, adverse surgical events may be due to poor communication, bad operative technique, malfunctioning or improperly used equipment, and cognitive errors due to stress or inattention, all compounded by resource and organizational problems. It is important to emphasize that all personnel working in operating theatres, including surgeons, operating theatre assistants, anesthesiologists, and cleaning personnel, must follow hygiene protocols very strictly. Elective surgery on infectious TB patients should be postponed until such patients have received adequate drug therapy. When emergency surgery is indicated for a suspected or diagnosed infectious TB patient, taking specific infection control measures is prudent. Infection control practices. Standard precautions. All operation theatre staff should follow standard precautions. Hand hygiene. In addition to hand hygiene, surgical hand hygiene plays an important role in reducing SSIs. Surgical hand scrub. Surgical hand scrub can be done with medicated soap or surgical hand rub with alcohol-based formulations. Either method is suitable for the prevention of surgical site infection. Steps for surgical hand preparation. Steps before starting surgical hand preparation. Keep nails short and pay attention to them when washing your hands. Most microbes on hands come from beneath the fingernails. Do not wear artificial nails or nail polish. Remove all jewelry, including rings, watches, bracelets, before entering the operating room or suite. Wash hands with a non-medicated soap before entering the operating room. Always use brush for cleaning hands if visibly soiled. Protocol for surgical scrub with a medicated soap. Start timing. Scrub each side of each finger between the fingers and the back and front of the hand for 2 minutes. Proceed to scrub the arms, keeping the hand higher than the arm at all times. This helps to avoid recontamination of the hands by water from the elbows and prevents bacteria-laden soap and water from contaminating the hands. Wash each side of the arm from wrist to the elbow for 1 minute. Repeat the process on the other hand and arm, keeping the hands above elbows at all times. If the hand touches anything except the brush at any time, the scrub must be lengthened by 1 minute for the area that has been contaminated. Rinse hands and arms by passing them through the water in one direction only, from fingertips to elbow. Do not move the arm back and forth through the water. The steps may be repeated 3 times and as recommended by hospital infection control guidelines. Proceed to the operating room or suite, holding hands above elbows. At all times during the scrub procedure, care should be taken not to splash water onto surgical attire. Once in the operating room or the suite, hands and arms should be dried using a sterile towel and aseptic technique before putting on gown and gloves. Correct aseptic technique should be followed to wear sterile gloves without contaminating the sterile surface. Protocol for surgical scrub with an alcohol-based preparation. The steps are same as hand wash. Hand hygiene training program for doctors, nursing staff, and housekeeping staff needs to be done regularly for each category of staff. Hand hygiene compliance need to be monitored. PPE. Please follow appropriate instructions on donning and doffing personal protective equipment in operating room. It is good practice to discard all used theatre wear prior to leaving the operating area to prevent healthcare workers, patients and visitors from being exposed to the risk of contamination. Healthcare personnel or HCPs in all areas. Wear dedicated non-sterile attire. Staff should keep their movements in and out of the operating room to a minimum. Semi-restricted and restricted areas of the surgical or invasive procedure setting. Wear clean surgical attire, including shoes, head covers, surgical masks, and identification badge. Head cover or cap should cover the hair on the head and face fully when entering the operating room. Surgical mask should cover the mouth and nose fully when entering operating room if an operation is about to begin or already underway, or if sterile instruments or equipment are exposed. Wear the mask throughout the operation. Scrub team members are required to put on sterile gloves after donning a sterile gown. Use surgical gowns that are effective barriers to liquid penetration. Skin preparation for surgical site disinfection. Perform hand hygiene. Wear appropriate PPE. Use disinfectants, for example, iodine compounds, followed by 70% alcohol. Cover with drape. Management of infected or colonized surgical personnel. Educate and encourage surgical personnel who have signs and symptoms of a transmissible infectious illness to report conditions promptly to their supervisory and occupational health service personnel.
Training of the hospital staff and repeated inculcation of the proper cleanliness culture, and these should be incorporated. This starts with the hospital staff themselves. So if the some patient is having some active infection or some training wounds or some infection, then they should avoid coming to the OT and these critical areas, and appropriate measures should be taken.
Antibiotic prophylaxis and mechanical bowel preparation. Administer an antibiotic prophylaxis only when indicated and select it based on its efficacy against the most common pathogens causing SSI for a specific operation and publish recommendations. Inform patients before the operation whenever possible if they will need antibiotic prophylaxis.
Second is antibiotic prophylaxis and mechanical bowel preparation. So these should be used very judiciously and only in patients in whom they are recommended. Not every patient requires antibiotic prophylaxis, and if they are overused, they will lead to antibiotic resistance.
Intraoperative measures. Ventilation and movement of staff. Follow the recommendations of the facility or local authorities on the ventilation requirements of an operating room. Keep operating room doors closed except as needed for passage of equipment, personnel, and patients. Limit the number of people entering the operating room to necessary personnel only. Asepsis and surgical technique. Adhere to standard principles of asepsis for all procedures, including placement of intravascular devices, spinal or epidural anesthesia catheters, and when dispensing and administering intravenous drugs. Assemble sterile equipment and solutions immediately prior to use. Handle tissue gently. Maintain effective hemostasis. Minimize devitalized tissue and foreign bodies, and eradicate dead space at the surgical site. Maintaining effective hemostasis. Maintain patient normothermia and prevent inadvertent perioperative hypothermia. Maintain optimal oxygenation during surgery and ensure that an appropriate hemoglobin saturation is maintained during surgery and recovery. Maintain adequate perfusion during surgery. Do not use intraoperative skin, re-disinfection, or antimicrobials in abdominal surgery to reduce the risk of surgical site infection.
Intraoperatively, it is important to use proper surgical technique, to use proper instruments, to cauterize the tissues properly, not to overuse the cautery, not to have hematomas, ensure proper hemostasis, and remove dead and devitalized tissues, and follow the proper procedures so that you have less incidence of postoperative infections.
Postoperative measures. The main purposes of surgical dressings are to allow appropriate assessment of the wound postoperatively, to absorb exudates, to ease pain, and to provide protection for newly forming tissues. Always ensure aseptic, non-touch dressing technique for the management of post-operative wound.
In the post-operative period, it is important that the proper care of the wound is taken, the proper dressings are done, and the best thing to do in the post-operative wounds is to remove the dressing on probably second post-operative if it is not particularly infected, and clean it with a normal saline solution, and then if the wound is not infected, we can leave it open or otherwise cover with a sterile gauze. And it is important to ensure that the patient's relatives and the patient's attendants are taught and they are made comfortable about the care of the wound, so that the post-operative period is smooth and without any problem. And these things go a long way in preventing sepsis in the hospitals and the critical patients, and lead to a significant saving of the resources. And these can be done at any place with proper following of the standard operating procedures.
Post-operative cleansing. The most appropriate and preferred cleansing solution is sterile normal saline because it is non-toxic and the isotonic solution does not damage healing tissues. The objective is to remove excess wound exudate or any mobile slough and wound debris. In choosing an antibiotic, one should consider the results of microbiological sensitivity tests and local sensitivity patterns. Please follow institutional antimicrobial policy for appropriate prophylaxis and treatment.
Well, infection control and prevention is extremely important, almost essential in every operation theater. This starts with a good planning and design of the operation theater with appropriate infection control practices, adequate sterilization techniques, and disinfection of the operation theater. The awareness of the staff and their practices in the operation theater is extremely important and plays a key role in prevention of operation theater related infections. As far as the preoperative antibiotic is concerned, there are appropriate cases when one may use the preoperative antibiotics. However, it is not required for each and every patient. So overall, a general cleanliness of the operation theater, the good practices of the staff, and a good infection and disinfection mechanism is important for prevention of hospital-acquired or OT-acquired infections.